Tatiana, Stéphane, welcome. Stéphane, you're CEO of La Française des Jeux. Tatiana, a serial entrepreneur, founder and CEO. We'll hear more about your activities in a minute. So as I was saying, while we're making progress in gender equality, and we've talked about a lot of that in the last few days, one area that is in dire need of funding is women tech entrepreneurs. Tatiana, yes. Can you give us a little bit of a lay of the land of how bad the situation might be?
Yes, of course. So I guess the problem we're addressing is the low rate of women-led startup funded by venture capital across the world, and specifically in France. So surprisingly, women entrepreneurs raise well less than male entrepreneurs, and the numbers are terrible. In 2017, if you take all the venture funding, which is about $90 billion, women entrepreneurs got only 2.7% of that. So 2.7 in 2017 and 2.2 in 2018. So the bad news is that it's going worse and worse, and in France, it's not going that much better since it's less than 3%.
Why does it matter?
Lots of reasons. Why does it matter? I guess because it's proven that startups that they have in their founding team female outperform by 63% their male peers, and also because startups are shaping the economy and the society of tomorrow. And if we continue that way, women would take absolutely no part in shaping that economy.
And I mean, where does the problem lie in your view? Is it on the side of the funders, on the side of the woman? Can you just paint a bit of a picture there?
Of course, I guess that there's a lot of subjects that we all talked about during this forum. I guess that what interests us specifically and how we can play on the numbers is to increase the number of women entrepreneurs. So today in France, we're only 9% of tech women entrepreneurs, which is not enough. And on the other side, we need to increase also the number of women in the teams, in the VC teams, because today in France, it's less than 10%. And if you take the United States, 74% of the whole venture team don't have one single woman. Now, one single woman in the decision maker of 74% of the VC teams in the US.
Stéphane, you're the CEO of a large company, La Française des Jeux, operating leader of sport and betting and lottery. What is your view about the situation and what are you doing about it?
Well, when we started to talk about this situation, when I met Tatiana and other women entrepreneurs, I started to realize that the situation looks very much to a situation that I knew and a lot of us knew several years ago, which was about women in boards. And when we started to ask why there were no women in boards, it's some years ago, but it's not so far away from now, we asked this question to, of course, big CEO of large companies, and they said, oh, we would love to have women on board, but we don't find any. It's very difficult. So we said, really, we cannot believe that. And as a matter of fact, as we all know now, in countries such as France, where you actually did put a quota, why we did put a quota? Because it was not moving. It happens that now you have, of course, 40% of women on boards of the large companies of CAC 40, and we are getting very close to that in other companies. And everybody agrees that it has been good for the boards of the company in terms of not only diversity, but of course new experience coming, rotation, new board members, more diversity of board profile and so on. So basically what I think is that the problem that we have with financing of women entrepreneurs is something that on which we can act. At the end of the day, we will see that it will be good not only for women but for the economy, as we all invest in innovation investment fund. So I thought it was a really good subject that we have now to take on which we have to take action.
So I believe you're setting up some sort of open innovation platform and trying to do something about that to close the gap. Can you tell us a bit more about this initiative?
Yeah, I just want to add one thing, and I'll answer your question, but clearly it would be a strange paradox if we were solving the problem in the corporate world, having more women in board and management, and no one or very few in the entrepreneur. So what does a corporate can do for that? Today, most of the large corporate companies do invest in investment funds because we are all aware that if we do not do that, we cannot capture innovation in our ecosystem. So we all investing. So as a corporate, we all choose investment funds to implement this policy. And my view is that we can use this leverage. Not, of course, to make the criteria of women the only criteria, but to put it in our panel of criteria when we do invest in those investment funds. Clearly, we have to look at what is the deal flow of those investment funds. We have to look at the strategy that those investment funds may have to increase share of women in this deal flow. We can look also at the team that the investment funds are having, because we know it's one of the factor that makes the situation more difficult for women entrepreneurship to get the trust of those teams. We can also invest in some specific programs to boost women for entering into the deal flows. There are a lot of ways. So really, what I want to say that a corporate has a lot of ways and means to encourage this. We just have to use our leverage, which is money, as usual.
And tell me a bit more then about the partnership, which is quite novel, I suppose, that you two and other organizations have partnered
together. That we're
together.
Joining forces. Yes. I guess it's been a few years that the ecosystem, the tech ecosystem, goes crazy around the fact that there's absolutely no women. And as an entrepreneur, it's something that, of course, is important for us. And I think that the new thing is that we're joining forces. It means that the only way for the venture capital to invest massively in women is, of course, to have a pressure from the corporates and the LP. So I think it's a problem that we can concretely solve together. Entrepreneurs by saying, I don't really want your money if you don't engage yourself in a diverse strategy. And on the corporate side, saying the same thing, I'm not giving you the money if you're not having a special focus on women entrepreneurs. So I believe that it's something that in a few years we can really concretely change.
I mean, I see the logic. You have here a room full of corporates, entrepreneurs. How will you make this true? What do you need for this to happen?
So we need to form a large coalition. So we need to join forces, of course, in the corporate sector, with the entrepreneur and with the investment fund that should become our partner in that. So we really call for a large coalition of forces to progress in the meantime. And we know that we are started very low, so it's easy to progress very quickly because we started from less than 3%. So if only we were to say that, well, it's feasible to reach 10%, which is a very small percentage, I think it would be something that we should all go for.
So I guess on the entrepreneur and the corporate side, if you want any type of information, don't hesitate to contact Stéphane and I. And the idea is then in the upcoming weeks, we're launching an initiative around aiming to increase the number of women-led startup funding.
Well, what will this initiative be called?
It's going to be called Sista.
Sista. Take good note. Anything else you'd like, a call for action for that audience?
So just to let the audience know that in the next weeks, we're going not only to have the Sista hashtag coming through, but with a platform and a website. So everybody will be able to participate and contribute to that. And we're looking forward to work with everybody on that. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Stay there. Stephen. 1 minute. So we're talking about a funding gap here, bridging the funding gap for tech entrepreneurs. Thank you very much for your contribution. I would like, if you wouldn't mind staying, inviting two of our storytellers to very quickly tell us a 60-second story of how they're building a bridge themselves. please join me in welcoming Sonia Ben Ali and Audrey Fontaine.
A few years ago, I've lost everything. I've lost my children, I've lost my job, and I've lost my country. And now I fight for every refugee like me to be able to truly restart their lives. This is what Mulki, a refugee woman from Somalia, told me recently. Mulki is one of the many refugee women who are striving to change lives in their communities and improve the lives of other people. But because she's a woman and because she's a refugee, the initiatives of Mulki are under-recognized and underfunded. My name is Sonia Ben Ali, and I founded the NGO Urban Refugees to Change That. We support refugee women like Mulki through training, coaching, and funding. We've built a replicable approach, and we believe we can change the lives of 2 million refugees in the 10 coming years. At the moment, we are looking for women ambassadors who could leverage their network for this cause. If you're interested, please reach out to me. Thank you.
Hi, thank you to the organizers for this amazing event. It's been really inspiring. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to talk here today. Just before I start my little seconds, which one of you would like their daughters to become a medical doctor? A few, okay, maybe less hands are gonna be after this. So I'm Audrey Fontaine. I'm the vice president of the French Junior Doctor Union. We represent 19,000 junior doctors across France. 2 years ago, we made a study on sexism in France, and we showed that 60% of female doctors, young doctors, are suffering from daily sexism, and 9% from sexual harassment. Most of them don't consider themselves as victims. So we've decided to start advocating against this, and we're putting up an international event in 2019 on this topic. So we're looking for partners, ideas, so please, if you want to help us, come and join us to encourage female doctors to have a good professional life. Thank you.
Thank you.